بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
আসসালামু আলাইকুম রহমতুল্লাহ ডিয়ার ভিউয়ার্স ওয়েলকাম টু ইউথ আওয়ার আপনার সবাইকে আমি স্বাগত জানাচ্ছি আমার নাম ইসলাম উই আর টকিং অ্যাবাউট এডুকেশন টুডে টপিক ইজ রিয়েলি রিয়েলি ইম্পর্টেন্ট ফর আস অ্যান্ড আলহামদুলিল্লাহ ইন আওয়ার বয়েজ অ্যান্ড গার্লস মাশাআল্লাহ দে ডুইং ভেরি ওয়েল ইন এডুকেশন সো ইন আ স্টুডিও উই হ্যাভ টু হাফিজ মাশাআল্লাহ এন এ প্লেসম্যান মাশাআল্লাহ উইল টক অ্যাবাউট এডুকেশন টুডে সো স্টে উইথ আস ইফ ইউ ওয়ান্ট টু কল আস ইউ ক্যান কল আস ডাইরেক্ট দেয়ার ইজ নাম্বার ইজ দেয়ার থ্যাংক ইউ জাযাকুমুল্লাহ খাইর on my right, we have Hafiz Kamran. How are you, sir?
I'm good.
So which school do you go to?
I'm currently studying A-levels at John Cash 6th
Form. MashaAllah. And your Islamic study, where did you...?
That was in my secondary school, which was London East Academy.
London East Academy. Okay. Yunus, tell me about yourself.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Welcome to our youth hour.
Yeah, I'm happy to be here.
MashaAllah. So you've been studying in the same place, London East Academy, right?
For secondary, yes.
MashaAllah. And what are you doing now?
At the moment, I go to college, London Academy of Excellence.
MashaAllah. Good.
And doing my A-levels.
Alhamdulillah. Welcome. On my left, MashaAllah, I'm sure he's very honored and very happy dad here on my left. Welcome to our show.
Walaikum salam. Yeah, thank you for having us here in the show.
Alhamdulillah. I'll come back to you because I'm really interested to talk to these young men, mashallah. You know, after you're full hafiz and you led Taraweeh in Islam, the mosque.
It's once.
Once. No, it's a big thing, subhanAllah. This is one of the biggest, you know, mosque in the Europe in a lot of different ways. And once you led it, that's really, really something. There's something special, mashallah. Tell me about your, especially your, to become a Hafiz, you need a lot of dedicated time, isn't it? How was it for you?
Well, I started when I was about 7 years old, so that was about year three, and it took me, quite a long time. Alhamdulillah, I managed to finish in year seven, so I started in about 2007, and I finished in 2012. So that's about five, six years. So it took a long time, but alhamdulillah, in the end, I got there.
Recently you had GCSEs as well, you done well in the GCSE, what did you have in your GCSE?
I got an A-star, 6 A's and 4 B's.
Alhamdulillah. Yunus, sir, you done very, very well, isn't it?
Alhamdulillah.
You know, it's not a competition, but Alhamdulillah, Allah deserves, what you deserve, Allah gives. How was your education? Tell me about Hafizi first. How was it? And what age did you start?
Okay, so I started in the primary school at East London Mosque. So there's the primary and the secondary sector. So I started when I was in year 6 and I finished by the end of year 7. So alhamdulillah, just under 2 years to complete.
SubhanAllah. It's amazing. What did you have in your GCSE?
Alhamdulillah, I got 9 A-stars and 3 A's in my GCSEs.
9 A-stars? Your mum must be very happy, man. Mum or dad, who's more happier then?
Competition.
Right. SubhanAllah, it's amazing, you know. I don't know what to say, man. I have 3 boys, but I couldn't afford it, you know, honestly. I feel so ashamed today, but yeah, why not? Mulaba, you must be very happy about your son. Ministers and Hafiz in 2 years. It's amazing.
Alhamdulillah, it's a blessing from Allah, and obviously the hard work and the teacher's hard work as well.
So what was your role in getting him into where he is now today? What role did you play? As a parent, it's a big role. It's about providing things he wants and in the time and quality time. What was your role?
Well, obviously, I mean, I had intention to make all my children. I got 2 boys and a daughter. And me and my wife had a firm intention to make them who fast first, give them a Islamic education first of all, first and foremost. Because to me, Islamic education comes first. And if you got your foundation right, then everything falls into place. So alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me. I'd made firm intention, and both him and my younger son both became Hafiz. And my daughter is on the way completing the Hifz as well. So we had very very we have guidelines at home where they'll come in every day from work, from school, and on the day off, like Saturday, Sunday, or even if we go to people's houses on weddings and all that, the HIFS time was set. So every time, I taught my children, wherever you go, wherever you are, when it comes to HIFS, they do the HIFS. And they
if you go to Kutumbari.
Yeah, Kutumbari, yeah, we have a set time, yeah. We set, they got this small Quran and they have it with them all the time. So wherever they go, HIFS time is set time. So I taught them from an early age that when it comes to, if you want to become a Hafiz, you have to be very dedicated first and foremost. If you're not dedicated and if you can't put time aside, it's very hard to accomplish. So which me and my wife both, wherever they went, they just did their HIFS on time and
so you have to be very extra careful about them.
You got to be
where they are, where they're going, because the timing is very important for you.
Exactly, yeah.
So the set time you said for study, HIFS study, is there a certain time like 6 to 7 or?
Well, it's a set time. Obviously, if you're at home, you can do 6 to 7. But if you go to, as you say, Kutumbari or wedding, you can't do 6 to 5.
Okay.
But as long as they do the half an hour or 1 hour at whatever time during the day, if you go to other people's house. But if you're at home, obviously, sometimes 6 to 5 when they come back from school, have something to do, watch some TV, cartoons, and all that, then do the HIFS. But if you go to other people's house or weddings or stuff like you can't allocate 6 to 5 to 6, but as long as they do it during the day, 1 hour during the day, whenever, so they don't miss their sabah.
Can I ask you something? Of course, you'll be honest. Was it difficult? Like, you went to Kutumbari, yeah? Everyone's playing about and everyone watching this, and your dad saying to you, it's the time. Or did he didn't have to say it? You know the time and you went to study.
Yeah, obviously, it's hard because, when you're young, you want to do other things. You don't always want to study. You don't always want to read. But you always have to have that mindset that, inshallah, I want to become Hafiz. I want to lead Salah. I want to become knowledgeable in all aspects of life. So with that in mind, you can have your play time, but you also have to have dedicated work time as well. So,
do you appreciate now, you're not that young anymore, do you appreciate now what your dad put you through?
Yes.
You have to be disciplined. That's how you do it. Without any, tough time, you don't learn. You don't get that. So in 2 years' time, you've done it. That's something very special. Normally, 3 years, 3.5, or five, like you said, most people in that line between that. But you've done it in 2 years, and you've also been to weddings, everything. But you maintained that standard your dad wanted. That's really, really amazing. Honestly, when you become my age, then you will exactly know what Hafizi means to you now, believe me. You will appreciate him a lot. And it's a lot of money as well. Kamran, tell me about yourself, sir. Is your mum and dad, of course, they put in a lot of effort as well, I'm sure. Did you have a set time or a certain lifestyle you had to change because of your Hafizi and education?
The way that worked for me was quite different to Yunus. So after school, so obviously I had to have, so my school day used to go, after school I used to go to an extra Quran kind of maktab kind of place where I used to do my all my lessons and prepare for the next day with another teacher. And that's the teacher, alhamdulillah, I finished with. So it was partly due to him, and of course my mum put me there, and it was kind of hard. Some days I used to be tired after school, but still, you make the effort and you go, inshallah.
Do you mind if I ask you to say a few lines, because you're Hafiz? I know he's not very well. Let's see how he goes at the end. I will ask him to say a few lines of Quran for our viewers.
Okay.
Can you recite, please, if you don't mind?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم
وأنيبوا إلى ربكم وأسلموا له من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب ثم لا تنصرون واتبعوا أحسن ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب بغتة وأنتم لا تشعرون صدق الله العظيم.
ما شاء الله, amazing. Is it possible to do two lines from you? If you feel, I know you got a bad throat today.
Okay, I'll try.
Yeah, go on.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا ومن الليل فتهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما محمودا وقل رب أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج صدق واجعلني من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا وقل جاء الحق وزهق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهوقا وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا تزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا وإذا أنعمنا على الإنسان أعرض ونأى بجانبه وإذا مسه الشر كان يئوسا قل كل يعمل على شاكلته فربكم أعلم بمن هو أهدى سبيلا صدق الله العظيم.
Alhamdulillah, you know, the tone and the voices, you know, it's quite different than Bangladeshi style of reading, isn't it? It's amazing. It's more like Arab style or Egyptian style, isn't it? Leba, you've been to Madrasa yourself.
Yes.
I'm sure there are a lot changed now than before, isn't it? Do you see any change in the in education system and style?
Well, I went to traditional madrasa where it was a boarding style where we had to stay there, and whereas nowadays madrasa like LEA where my son and Kamran went to, it's more of like a school, you know, normal state school where they go and come back. It's not boarding or anything. And obviously, I mean, there's good side and bad side to both. Where I went was a boarding school, and we used to be homesick. So I still come in and come in weekend in four, or come in I think every 4 weeks, once for 3 days, and on Sunday evening we had to go back, and it was very difficult for us to go back. So we go back on Sunday, then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, it gets another few days to go back used to the routine. So that side of it I didn't really like. So that's what, another thing when I decided, when we decided I'm going to send my son to become a Hafiz, that's another choice we had to make, whether sending to boarding traditionals, mothers are or what's available, and we decided to send it, you know, to LEA where they come back home every day. And
There is a change in education, I mean, especially in madrasa style, they're changing. You know, there used to be a lot of memorization and lots of different way of doing things. Now, do you have to have GCSE? Do you have to have, you know, different style in it? Do you think it's better for the future of our young kids, especially in this country, UK? They're going to madrasa if they don't know the basic stuff, if they don't have a level GCSE, but how would they find a good job and stuff like that? So it's a change now, mashallah. What do you think?
Obviously there's a change, and obviously as you said, it's very important to have your, obviously it's very important to have your Islamic studies. On the other hand, you need GCSEs and national curriculum as well, because if you're going to live in this country, you need to work. And obviously as a Muslim, you should aim for high, not just become Hafiz and be content with it. We should aim for high. We should become doctors and engineers and journalists and whatever available there. As a Muslim, we should be, you know, always aiming for high. And yeah, and
I think, as a, I mean, your job as a policeman, just asking you as a person of, you know, Bangladeshi, you will know a lot of young people are into bad stuff nowadays. You know, you would know more than us. You don't have to make comments if you don't want to. Like, they're into drugs, there is gangs, there is, you know, stabbings happening, bullying, you know, you name it. All there are a lot of Muslims in the prison. 10% of the people, the population, are Muslim, that's been had. And it's a big number when we are only 3 or 4% of the population of the country. So how do we, how do you see we tackle that? Do you, I mean, these guys, if I even ask them, they won't know much about it because they've not even been close to it. They're more like really innocent guys. They haven't got time to go to the king and stuff like that. They, you know, you guys done very well for them. But for the rest of them, what do you think we should do for them?
I don't know, it's a very unfortunate thing what you just said, what's happening in our communities. But obviously, I mean, so it's down to so many aspects of life, like lack of Islamic educations, and what the children are going out, mixing with wrong sorts of people and doing this, all this nasty stuff. But obviously, I mean, as I said, education plays a very important role in our life as Muslims, both in Islamic terms and of national curriculum. Because sometimes, like with the lack of education, you like go out and mix in with the wrong sorts of people and end up in prison and all that.
Cameron, can I ask you something? How old are you now?
I'm 16.
Okay. You know, when you went to college now, mashallah, you got a big ambition, you're going to become a doctor, mashallah, good. But I want to ask you, when you went to Madrasa, LEA,
yeah,
and went to college, the atmosphere, how different was it?
Oh, subhanAllah, it was quite a culture shock, maybe. Because I not only have been in secondary school for Islamic school, I've already been to a primary school that was Islamic as well. So it was kind of the same. And once I, you know, obviously left secondary school, it was weird seeing all this new stuff, you know, something that I've never been used to before. And still till now, I mean, it's only been like a month of college. So it's going to take some time getting used to. But some stuff I wish that I did have, you know, social skills, how to talk to non-Muslims, stuff that I wish I had those skills. And, you know, I think this thing that I should have had experience of, because now it's a struggle.
You think you missed it? I mean, you didn't have that?
No, I didn't have that, obviously, in Islamic school. You know, you don't have some of these skills.
Okay. I think that is very true. I mean, that is something, when you're in Islamic school environment, all the Muslim boys and your teachers, you don't have connection with wider society at all. And social skills are so important. You know, what you say, when you say it, how do you say it is very important. Now you're learning that part. Imagine if you're a full Hafiz. In Bangla design, you're a Masab already, full Masab package. And actually, it's negative, but you didn't have those skills. Now you know now, because you've been somewhere already. If I told you before, you went to the college, said, you don't have those skills, you wouldn't agree with me. You would say, what are you talking about? You can't even read surah properly and you're telling me what to do. But now you're realizing, actually, communication skills is so important for everything. What do you find the most difficult part in college when you went there? It's like a culture shock, you said.
Probably just getting along with everyone, you know, talking to non-Muslims, knowing how to communicate with people. It's quite different, you know. Simple stuff like, in obviously when you're in secondary school, refer to the teachers as Ustad, means like teacher. Well, you know, in college, you'll have to remember like, oh, miss or sir. So it's small stuff that you have to get used to.
Because in Islamic school, you're more respectable, isn't it? Your teacher, as saying, is a very highly respected person.
Like Assalamu alaikum or inshallah. You can't really say that stuff out loud, especially when they're non-Muslim. They're going to think like, oh, who's this guy?
Do you call them by names, especially in college now? I'm sure you'll find it difficult by calling by names.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of Islam, actually. You know, it gives you adab that when you see your elders, when you see your even your teachers, anybody else, we don't use names with respect. You know, it's not that we can call them by names. Names are therefore called, but because of the respect thing, it's just amazing. They're probably thinking, do you shy a lot? I mean, for you, it's a culture shock, like you said, you've been there. Do you feel other people are just like mingling all the time and talking everything, and you just look back and say, oh my God, what should I do?
It's exactly like that, actually, yeah.
Tell
it's
me about you.
Some time to
that's taking one. Go on, Yunus, tell me about you. How was it for you?
Oh, the first week was difficult because I was also at Islamic environment for 5-6 years. So just moving on to transitioning to a place where there's not as many Muslims, not as many Asians as well.
Which one do you go to?
At the moment, I go to London Academy of Excellence. It's a college in Stratford.
Okay.
So, yeah. But it's still in my Islamic school. Everyone was at the top of the studies as well. So that stayed the same in college as well, because everyone's up there in their knowledge, in the studies. So that's one thing that helped as well. So despite a culture shock, I could still mingle with studies, common interests, stuff like that.
Do you find difficult making friends? Do you find difficult? Because, you know, in state school, it's just like you have to be, you know, not rude, but you have to be certain stylish, and, you know, that's what they like. But you guys coming from a angle of very, don't say much. You say what if you want to say, if you have to say, and you're more reserved. Is that the case in Madrasa?
I mean,
oh, it's not.
I think people have a common perception of Madrasa, things like okay. some that were kind of say like, you know, like monks, you know. Okay. Well, yeah, we have common interests, you know, we still talk about stuff that's still going on. We're not like some secluded kind of cave people that just live somewhere. No, we still have our common interests, you know, we talk about things, and you know, it's not that so much different. So yeah, it's still okay.
You know, it's true. That is true. That's where I'm. Okay, we're just going to go for a small break, and I'm going to come back to you on that.
Okay.
Dear viewers, stay with us. We're just going to go for a small break, inshallah, and see you after the break. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.